I mentioned at the start of this module that we are going to try something a little bit more clever than just going along a descent direction. So to build up to that, we want to generalize our ideas, particularly of orthogonality. Okay, so when we said orthogonality, let's say of Pi and Pj, what did it imply? If I said that Pi and Pj were orthogonal, very simply, it just means that Pi transpose Pj is equal to 0, I not equal to j, right? Now, very similar to this property is a property called conjugacy. The first C of the name of the method has the word conjugate gradient. What does conjugate mean? So, conjugacy simply means that Pi A So, if Pi transpose APJ is equal to 0 for all I different from J, then we say that these two vectors Pi and Pj are A conjugate with respect to each other. Okay. So if I take all of these P starting from P0 up to Pn minus 1, I have n vectors. Okay. We say that this set is conjugate with respect to a positive definite matrix. That's just a definition. Okay, this is just a definition. We are not saying anything about the case when I equal to j. Okay, whether it should be 1 or something else, that really doesn't matter. All we need is that it should be not orthogonal but conjugate with respect to A. Now you might ask, so what? Okay, I've defined another kind of a, looks like a generalized what? Can I write this expression in terms of a norm? Just to brush up linear algebra, you had it in the quiz as well, right? If A is positive definite, is square root of A defined? What is it? U root I lambda to the power half U transpose. That's the, if you know the eigenvalue decomposition, the square root just comes like this. So I could write this and let's call this Q, right? So then if I define norm with respect to this, what happens over here, right? I'm going to get X transpose Q, wait a minute. So I don't actually need to take square root Q. Okay, so let's just call this A. It's kind of like a generalized inner product also. Anyway, this is not important. Let's scratch this out. Okay, so getting back to these newly defined conjugate vectors, first question is, who cares? What is so special about them? Now, it turns out that if these n vectors are conjugate with respect to a positive definite matrix A, there's a surprising property that comes, which is going to be the basis of the conjugate gradient method. So let's note it down. If these vectors are conjugate with respect to A, it turns out, any guesses? It's surprising. You wouldn't expect it. These PIs end up being linearly independent, right? Not at all clear from the definition. These PIs are of course, it's not satisfying to just have this property be listed out like this. We want to know how did this happen, right? So when we were doing proofs, what was one of the first tricks in the bag to prove something like this? Contradiction, right? So let's see if our old friend helps us out over here. Okay. So I'm going to take, let us say, I'm going to take L such vectors I'm going to take. Okay. Now, what does proof by contradiction mean here? What is the contradictory statement? They are not linearly independent. That means they are linearly dependent. That means I can express what? I can express any one of the vectors as a linear combination of all the others. That's the meaning. So let's put that down, right? So that simply means that if I take, say, some pk, this is going to be written as a linear combination of what is my I, pi. This is almost correct, but what should I do in this summation? I not equal to k, because it doesn't make sense. I mean, I want to write pk in terms of all other vectors. So I'll just exclude k from the summation. If this is the case, then pk is linearly dependent. It can be written in terms of other guys. And that's what we want to, right? So this is what we want to see. Does this lead to a contradiction? What would your next step be? What do you know about these p's? I need to somehow get A into action, right? So if I want to get A into action, what do I do? Left multiply by A, and then left multiply by some other P, right, to get this into action, right? So the best thing to left multiply would be, so left, I'm going to put a PK transpose A. If I stick this in, it's going to be great. Right, because what will the left hand side be? I'm going to get pk transpose a pk. What's going to happen to the right hand side? Right, so alpha I, let's just write it out explicitly, a pi, I is equal to 1 to l, I is not equal to k. Right, so the property of conjugacy is going to give the right hand side to be obviously 0, because there is no pk left to act on. This is going to be 0, okay. Now, if this is 0, let's open this up over here, okay. Now, what is the best way of doing this? So, for example, A, I could have written it in terms of U lambda U transpose. I can also write it in the outer product notation. Does anyone remember what the outer product way of writing it is? Lambda I ui transpose ui, that is one way of writing it, right? It doesn't matter, I mean, you can write it like this also. And let's open this up, okay? So this is also equal to I is equal to 1 to n lambda I ui ui transpose, okay? Is everyone familiar with this? You should have seen it during linear algebra. This is called the outer product. What is nice about it is that I have written a, what is the rank of A? If it's positive definite, it's n, rank n. What is the rank of ui ui transpose? It's rank 1. Why? Because you will see every row is a multiple of each other. Therefore, it's just rank 1. So I'm writing a rank n matrix as the sum of n one rank matrices. So this is actually very, very useful in things like dimensionality reduction and so on. So in image processing, these kind of ideas are used heavily. Okay. Yeah, question. Correct. Yeah, I'm getting to it. I'm just explicitly showing it out over here. Now, A, yeah, so if I open this up over here, now if I stick pk transpose pk on both sides, what am I going to get? I'm going to get a summation lambda I pk transpose ui and ui transpose pk. Okay. Which is nothing but, I see the same vector with the transpose. So therefore, this can be written as lambda I times what? Norm squared of the vector. Right, it's the same vector in transpose form. Ui transpose pk, if I take its transpose, I get pk transpose ui. So therefore, this is norm squared of ui pk transpose squared. So do you see the contradiction now? It's a positive definite matrix. Therefore, the lambda i's are strictly greater than 0. This is a norm square, right? I'm obviously assuming that the p's are not 0, that pk is not 0. That's not a useful thing to consider. So, this is also greater than 0. Yet, this summation is equal to 0. So, it's as simple as that. So, this is a a contradiction. Okay. Any questions on this? So, most of what we have, not most, entirely everything that we have done so far has just been simple linear algebra, starting with eigenvalue decomposition. And what we have proven is an interesting result, that if you give me the conjugacy condition, it turns out that the p's are going to be linearly independent. That's interesting. That's probably, have you encountered any other way of generating linearly independent vectors? Gram-Schmidt is one process. Gram-Schmidt actually went several steps ahead, right? It made them orthogonal to each other, right? Here is, you give me an input matrix A. I'm not telling you the algorithm, but there exist n linearly independent vectors which satisfy this property. Okay, so that's something new.